Sound.
You are listening to KUPS 90.1 FM Tacoma, the Groovy Movie Hour. I'm Chase.
I'm Skyler.
We're the only ones in the booth today.
Yeah, no idea where Connor and Jeremy are.
It's okay, though. We watched Arrival, one of our most, probably the most recent movie we've ever watched.
Oh, yeah, by far. Yeah, this one's still in theaters. And if you haven't seen the movie, spoilers.
A lot of spoilers.
We're going to spoil the entire movie for you.
We'll give periodic updates, but the entire movie is going to be spoiled.
Yes.
Just so
yes.
Everyone's aware.
And this movie is amazing if you go into it blind.
Absolutely.
It's really, really fun to go into it blind and not know kind of what happens later on. So if you're okay with spoilers, by all means, listen on. But
because even watching the trailers, you didn't really know anything, like small glimpses, like if you heard the liner we just played, you hear the sounds of them, you hear sort of what she's there for, which is to like translate with them and help try and communicate.
I didn't even know that going into the movie. All I saw was like the tagline and like the posters.
That was probably the best way to do it, because then it's even better. What were your thoughts after seeing it?
I would give this movie an A-.
Mm-hmm.
If I were to rate it, I had a few small problems with it.
That's okay.
But like overall, it was really good. Let's do what we usually do, and let's go through the plot real quick.
So
then we can talk about it that way.
So this is a film directed by Denis Villeneuve.
Denis.
Oh yeah, it is Denis.
He's French Canadian.
It is Denis Villeneuve. Stars Amy Adams and
Jeremy Renner. Yeah,
Forrest Whitaker. And Forrest Whitaker. Although he's not in it as much as I was expecting.
Yeah,
he was a lot more prominently featured in the trailer than I thought Jeremy Renner was.
I don't really like his character anyway, so.
Oh, okay. Well, there we go. Essentially, when mysterious spacecraft touch down across the globe, an elite team led by expert linguist Louise Banks, played by Amy Adams, is brought together to investigate. As mankind teeters on the verge of global war, Banks and the team race against time for answers, and to find them, she will take a chance that could threaten her life and quite possibly humanity. That was the very generic IMDb cliche.
Yeah.
It's that makes it sound like a dumb action movie, but essentially it's like a lot slower, more interesting build up, because like the first half hour is probably my favorite part of the movie. It starts off with what we think is flashbacks,
we see these like flashbacks of Amy Adams with like a little girl, and like they happen throughout the entire movie, and up until a certain point you just think, oh, she's flashing back to these like awful memories she has of when like her daughter died, because it's this really like heart-wrenching first scenes in the first couple bits of the movie where like her daughter is like young
sick.
And or she's like young and then she's like, I love you, and then she's like, I hate you, when she's a teenager and she's rebellious and stuff. But
then it flashes to Amy Adams, current day, playing Louise Banks, and she's a professor. She's very well regarded and esteemed, it seems. Mm-hmm. And like one of the first scenes we see is her just like walking into this terminal, and like everyone else is crowded around a screen.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And she's just kind of like, oh, this is weird.
The people with their like peasantry and like their non-interest.
Looking at TV screens and
stuff. Exactly. She seems above it all, at least. Mm-hmm.
And everyone seems kind of panicked, and then like
she gets to her class, and there's like four people in it.
Uh-huh.
And it's like a huge lecture hall.
Yeah.
And this is one of those scenes that I really liked, because even though I feel like we've seen stuff like this done before, where like everyone's phone starts making noises, just the like, I don't know, the general like emptiness of it, because this is like only the second real place we've seen.
Yeah.
Besides the flashbacks.
Because everything else is just kind of like flashbacks and like, scenes from like there's like a shot like in her house, but you don't know it's her house, and there's like some like, narration, a little narration.
It builds tension in a very interesting way, because you sort of see like news clips in the background, but very quickly it shifts away from like that where
it just shows their reaction.
Right.
Like the students in the classroom where she's like trying to give a lecture are like, can you turn like a news station on, please? And she's like, all right, she turns it on TV.
And she doesn't question it. Normally, if you cut off them in the middle of class, would be like, no, we're doing class.
Extenuating circumstances.
Right.
So, like, they have these shots where it's just, like, it's Amy Adams, and she's, like, looking at it. She's, like, dead center of the frame. And it's just showing all these people's reactions, which is what I like. It was kind of reminiscent.
It didn't cut away.
Yeah, it was kind of reminiscent of Signs.
It took its time with it, yeah.
Yeah. In that sense. I like how they just focused on the reactions of the characters rather than just like showing the aliens themselves, which is one thing I really liked about this movie. Is, and one thing that's good about a lot of, or that needs to be good with a lot of alien movies, where alien movies, they're about people and they use the aliens as a context to talk about people, not just like, oh, look at these aliens that are here and they're blowing stuff up. Whoa, right. like stuff like Independence Day. It's like, it's a reflection for humanity, which is one good thing that's about this movie that I'll bring up more and more as we get through this.
Because speaking of the people in it, Amy Adams, we see her interact with no one up to this point. She's living alone. We don't have one of those scenes where it's like her and a colleague at work like saying, ah, oh, these aliens, aren't they pretty, pretty wild, right? But instead it's just like we see her teaching a class, and then the only other interaction we have is like her calling her mom at home. Which was just very interesting, because there was like, this movie had a good sense of humor and didn't take itself too seriously. There was the conversation she has with her mom, where her mom's like saying something like, oh, I heard on the news or the radio or something. She's like, don't listen to those people. Those people are just idiots.
Yeah.
It's like sort of poking fun at like the tendency to like cut away to like those news broadcasts that then like inform us in that way. And it also just shows she has a relationship with her mom, but she sounds really like just not interested in talking with her mom.
Yeah.
And then she just like drinks wine and like stays at home, goes back to work. No one else is there.
Yeah.
There was the great juxtaposition of the scene where everyone was rushing out of the school, and then they do the reverse of it, of her walking back to the school in the empty courtyard that we'd just seen like packed with people panicking.
Because like at the end of this class period, like an alarm goes off, like a siren, and everyone like gets out of there. And then,
as you would expect of these giant orb things,
so they like they keep maintaining this like tension as they move through. Like they haven't shown that like the pods that come down that are like on the on like the posters,
and there's and like seven of them.
The number doesn't really matter, but
enough to be in like the major superpowers of the world.
They said they touched down in completely like
right, but it's like in adjacent to China, in like Montana, part. Like it affects like
Alabama.
All the geopolitics. Yeah, Alabama. Sorry, Montana.
There's some in like the middle of the ocean. There's like one in there.
So they like form a like blockade around it.
Yeah.
But essentially she goes back to work. No one's there. And that's when we see Forrest Whitaker's character come in, who has heard of her, is trying to recruit her, has a small recording device.
They've worked with her before.
Right. Oh, yeah, they have worked with her.
Yeah.
They established that. Yeah.
So Forrest Whitaker's this like army general guy, and he's like your very typical like army general. Like, I'm here for results and I work by a plan and I'm very, you know, methodical, like the kind of that kind of guy. And he brings in with a recorder and he plays the sound of the aliens, and he's like, can you translate this? Like, oh, you were able to translate it last time, that like Farsi translation or whatever it was.
And she says, I would need to see it face to face.
Yeah.
And he's
like,
I'm going to walk out the door. This is the last chance you get.
Yeah.
And then she has one line, because she knows who they're going to next.
Yeah.
She says, ask him how to translate this one thing.
He's like, ask him the like Swahili translation for war or something.
Right.
And I don't really know what that means, but whatever it was,
it was a test. She was showing that she was superior, because he comes back to her house, like lands a helicopter outside her house.
Yeah, and is like, come with us.
And immediately was like, oh, well, she's like, what did he translate it as? And he tells her, and she's like, nope, that's wrong. And he's like, pack your bag. You got 5 minutes. We're going to be there for like months and months, which is, without getting too far ahead, what I like is like this first part felt really contained. And I do like how they expanded it out a little bit, to where it's like them going through the like process of translating and doing all these things. But I don't know, this first little bit, it was just like very interesting character study of this one person who we don't know a whole lot about, except the day the world is ending, she still goes into work. That's a really rich idea.
And like we have this like characterization of what we are led to believe is her daughter like dying of cancer in the past, apparently.
Apparently.
We'll get there.
So she goes
to the base. And one shot that I want to point out that is kind of reoccurring is
From the house.
Is like from inside the house looking out. She has this big house. There's these huge floor-to-ceiling glass windows looking out into like an ocean, but it's very foggy the whole time, so you can't see much throughout the windows. And this shot will like... I'll bring it up later, because it's...
It gets reincorporated.
It's telling when they're inside the pods later on in the movie.
Because then we see her taking off in the helicopter from inside her own house, as if we're like being left behind. I don't know, there were all these just like interesting camera positions.
Yeah.
But when she's flying there, she talks with this person, Jeremy Renner's
character. That's where they meet.
They meet. He quotes something from her book about, like, language being the most important thing and, like, to establish, like, all these different connections.
Yeah, but he's like, oh, but it's not. Haha, it's science.
It's math. And yeah, she sort of is jokingly self-deprecating, like, that's what you write to a foreword to a book because it's, like, eye-catching. It's sort of like a clickbait-esque thing to, like, get people to read the rest of your book. But essentially, they form sort of a repartee a little bit. Then they land. But before they land, and this is, like, an amazing shot, was just the patience with which it, like, showed the pod, the entire army encampment, the score.
Oh, yeah. Like, the first, like, the introductory shot, like, the first shot we see of the pods is amazing. Like it's this huge, really, really long soaring shot over, like, the fence that's outside, and there's, like, protesters all over it. There's, like, hundreds of people outside, and then they go over, like, the camps. And then it's this huge shot of, like, rolling fog over the hills and then, like, the pod right in the middle of it. It's a gorgeous shot. It's an amazing introduction for these pods.
The person who did the score, Johan Johansson, who has an amazing name, also collaborated with Denis Villeneuve on Sicario. And the score felt like you could definitely, like, see his fingerprints on it. But it was just incredible. And, like, the large... It reminded me, there's this one shot in Sicario where it's just over a landscape. This opening shot of the pod and the base reminded me of that.
I haven't seen Sicario, unfortunately. I really need to.
It's also very good. I think this is a little bit better for a couple different reasons, but this is one where it's just, like, you can see both the fingerprints from Johan Johansson's score and just the, like, patience of that one shot. Because I almost was sitting there, like, I wanted to go longer. But then, like
the cut, shot of the first shot of the pod?
Yeah, but then the cut was just perfect for then. It's like, okay, that was good. We're there. They're walking in. They immediately see someone being carted out on a little, what is it called? Where it's like someone's injured.
Oh,
getting, like medevaced out.
Oh, yeah, like a gurney or something.
A gurney, yeah. Getting carted out on a gurney.
And they're in this, like, military encampment that's, like, I don't know, maybe, like, a kilometer from the pod or something. Like, the closest you can possibly get to this thing. Like, the military's cordoned off the entire section around it. And then you see these, like, inside shots of, like, the command center. And there's this big board that's connected to all the other countries that have, like, teams working on, like, how to communicate with them and, like, there's, like, Sweden and France and Great Britain and, like, everything, and they're all trying to communicate, which is a big theme of this movie, communication.
And
language in general. And then...
Also, miscommunication, I feel like, is worth noting well.
Yeah. So let's see, what happens next? Next, does she get sent up into the...
Well, they go through, like, the entire process of asking them about, like, their medical history.
Oh, Jeremy's here!
Jeremy's here. He has arrived on time.
Arrival. Yaldrix never remembered to text me or anything when I forget to show up.
Well, why should I have to remind you?
I just feel like you don't even want me here then, though.
We should just be able to communicate through
universal
language.
I got in my car to, like, drive from class to get some food.
Uh-huh.
And then I was like, huh.
Oh, yeah.
These guys are talking about Arrival.
Wait,
is there another, like, Cups show that talks about movies or something?
So you heard us. How do we
wait,
sound?
This is my show.
Wow, this is some meta stuff happening right now. We were just about at the point where they are about to go up because they've gone through the process of, like, getting themselves checked out. Mm-hmm. The doctor asks, like, the question of, like, when was the last time you were in a stressful situation? She answers seriously. Jeremy Renner's like, now. Because it's like this, it's very clear he's kind of a more fish out of water in this case. She seems more ready of herself in a lot of different ways. Because she's like, oh yeah, when I was getting, like, taken out of this one, like, war zone or something. And I don't know, she seems a lot more on her feet. I really liked her character as compared to, like, some of the other characters Amy Adams has played. This one just felt, like, uniquely different. Especially because, like, she's in a bunch of movies lately. She's going to be in the one Nocturnal Animals. And that character looks wildly different. I don't know. I really like the way that she brought a lot of, like,
Amy
interesting
Adams is great.
Yeah.
I feel like she's always been a great actress, but hasn't really been given, like, great roles.
She was good in American Hustle. She was
I definitely liked her in American Hustle. I think it's only recently that people have started to offer her roles that have, like, much more fleshed out and, like, interesting and challenging
beyond
roles.
Talladega Nights.
Yeah. Or, like, I don't know. She was all right in The Fighter.
Yeah, I agree. So, anyway, continuing on.
They, like, put on these, like, full hazmat suits, like,
for
face
radioactive,
masks and, like, oh, yeah, just, like, everything, because... They're still like, oh, we don't know what's, like, going on with these things, or what could be, like, deadly within these pods. So they drive out there in these, like, pickup trucks. And
I liked how just, like, simplified it felt. It wasn't like they were going in huge military caravans. Like, it it sort of expressed how, like, rushed together some of these things were. Mm-hmm. That they were just like, we got to get a bunch of trucks, put on the suits.
Throw them out there. Like,
but then
it,
they, it's like they have the high-tech stuff, but then they also, like, have a canary like you would in a coal mine.
Yeah.
Like, that's so interesting. Uh-huh. Just, like, I don't know if it made any sense, but it was cool and I liked it.
Yeah, yeah.
Wait, why do you have canaries in coal mines?
Because if the bird dies, you know to get out.
It's because they're very, very sensitive to changes in, like, CO2 and other things. Like, far more sensitive. So they'll just pass out at the slightest, like, change. So then they're like, oh, bird died, time to beat it.
Exactly.
It's a
pre-warning sign.
That's cool. That's,
yeah.
But essentially, they go up on this ladder that just raises
a scissor lift, which is the tallest scissor lift ever.
I like, was watching it like, whoa.
It goes up like 100 feet. Like, how tall is this scissor lift?
But the entire scene building tension is just really great.
Yeah, because they like get in there and then
gravity switches.
Scene when like they first touch it and then it puts them up even further. And so they're like inside the pod. This like door opens. They say like this like door opens every 17 hours and they like go up there. And the craziest, like, the first part where you're like, holy cow, like, what are these, like, beings capable of, is they get, like, halfway up this, like, shaft, and gravity switches.
So they're, like, jump off upwards.
Yeah, they jump up, and then gravity switches, so then they're, like...
Walking where they were, like, facing up
before. Yeah, yeah, so they're now, like, perpendicular to where they were. And this was the part where, like the two, they go up with, like, two people that have, like, done this before. So it's Jeremy Renner and Amy Adams. And
this is the one moment where she sort of loses it.
Yeah,
she starts to panic a little bit.
And one of my favorite like kind of things to think about during this movie was what was going on inside like the character of Jeremy Renner's head, because he's like the scientist guy. He's there to
and
find
this
out. Like,
goes against everything.
Yeah, he's the guy to like find out what's like what they're capable of. Like when we were first introduced to his character, he's like, oh yeah, like if they're capable of light speed travel, like what else are they capable of?
And like, one thing like people use is to say it's as certain as gravity is a metaphor. Yeah. Here is gravity now becoming uncertain.
Like they're capable of like manipulating gravity. Like. Inside his mind, he would just be mind blown, like entirely, like trying to rationalize, like what, like I don't know. It was just really cool to think about.
It's a good example,
like trying to figure out how that's possible, like from his mind is just like he did a really good job. I think he did a great job of just being like what the hell is going on? Like this doesn't make any sense scientifically.
It's a good example of showing not telling, where these characters have everything that they've learned and been taught and believe in subverted, and they don't then have the scene of, oh, this changes everything I known. It's more just we get to see their reaction to it and see like their entire world shatter around them and then just keep going and
I thought
adapt.
The way they did that scene was pretty cool too. Like just weird shifts in gravity and stuff has kind of been a sci-fi film staple for a very long time. Like ever since 2001, they had that. What's the name for those kind of spaceships that are like circular?
Circular rotary spaceships. I don't know.
No, there's a name for it, but I can't remember. Anyways, not really important. But yeah, in this movie, they still managed to do a really cool job of taking that. It's sort of a sci-fi trope, I guess, but they adapted it in a really interesting and cool way. And
it takes
really
existing
well
tropes and does it really well.
The cinematography was also amazing in this movie. I heard you guys talking about that a little bit in my car ride over here.
It wasn't Roger Deakins, but it was still really good.
Yeah.
Roger Deakins, who he had worked with on like Sicario. Yeah.
Who did he work with? Wasn't it Lubezki?
I think
on
it
Prisoners?
Might have been. Yeah.
I wonder who it was on this movie.
I think it was on Prisoners for Lubezki.
We'll fact check that one. But essentially, because this first like 30 minutes, I want to say 30 to 40 minutes is just really great. But then it sort of picks up and a lot of stuff happens. They have their first encounter with them. She says her name. She tries to introduce herself.
We should go a little more in depth into that first like introduction.
Okay.
Because it's really, really important. They like walk into this like cavern. It's just this like kind of like rectangular,
box.
Probably like, you know, like. 30-foot high ceilings, just like all the floors is just this like kind of textured black kind of walls, ceiling, everything's kind of the same, and there's just this white rectangle. Again, remember when I said that shot of her house in the beginning when it's like looking out into like the fog, it's that like black or white rectangle, very reminiscent shot. And it's like looking into this like fog, and they try and like speak to it, like she brings like a whiteboard and writes like her name on it,
which she snuck in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Roger Deakins did the cinematography on Prisoners. It was actually Bradford Young in this movie, Arrival. He's done a couple other things, but not
did a good job still, yeah.
Did a great job.
But anyway, she writes her name down to try and introduce herself as sort of the baseline for communication. She explains why that's important later about how do they understand the concept of self and identity in the same way? Will they be able to name someone as being their own individual, or do they have a more shared consciousness?
Yeah, because like the general sends her in there with like the purpose of like asking the question, what is your purpose here?
Right.
Yeah.
Which she says is not something you can just start off with, because they have to understand what is purpose, who is a person, what can be this driving force, do they believe in this driving force?
They have to understand motivation.
Exactly. Yeah. And so it's like really interesting to see her break that down into just the one question of, she's like, what is your name?
And she's like trying to explain it to the general, and she's like panicking, trying to like do this, like trying to...
But she makes sense. I buy into her character. Yeah. She's very relatable, and she does a good job of breaking down everything in ways that don't ever... feel like, not to dump on Nolan, but don't feel like a Matthew McConaughey sticking a pen through a paper teaching scene. It has significance in the movie.
Yeah. I didn't really like the Colonel's character at times. He seemed really like expositional. Like
a little bit.
Like he just kind of showed up and was like, here's everything the audience needs to know.
Like, but we're with her. Like, it's a common thing in a storytelling device to have a character brought into a new situation so we can learn everything with them. So it makes sense that she would be learning these things and we're learning along with her. And then she's teaching the Colonel things that we didn't know either. And it all meshes together pretty well.
Creative ways to do exposition in stories is something that's just like really difficult. Like, it's kind of like learning how the sausage is made if you really start to paying attention. If you really start paying attention to every, like... way that expositional dialogue happens in a movie or in like watch a TV pilot.
Oh,
it's horrifying how often people throw out names of characters just in ridiculous ways. Like, hey, Skylar, how are you doing, Skylar? What's your day been up to, Skylar? Is your mom still suffering from that debilitating disease, Skylar?
Remember this long relationship we've had?
It's like, hey, my good friend, I've been friends with you for this many years.
But this movie does it well, where it's, we know why.
They do it all
right. Well, we know why they're going to talk to her, which is that she's qualified.
Yeah, yeah.
So they don't need to then like list the qualifications. We then learn that she's qualified, what she does, where they reference like the one moment of past relationships because he says, that's why I came to you, here's what we have. Yeah. It's very quick and it's very efficient.
This movie does a relatively good job of showing and not telling, I'd say.
Yeah, because essentially the scene happens where she walks forward more than anyone has done. They achieve more because they... with their tentacles, they're effectively these large squid-like beings that do emit sounds, which you heard in the liner we played earlier that we'll play for Jeremy, because I don't know if Jeremy heard it, because it's cool. They emit these sounds, but then also with their tentacles spray this circular message onto this wall that is separating them, and then that's the end of the like first encounter. In a lot of ways, not exactly the same. It reminded me of Ex Machina, how it's the wall separating them, and there's like this like continued encounters. Then we see the implications, what the plan is going to be next, and then sort of building from there. Obviously, this ends up like moving a lot faster, where they just like do a montage of them working through things and communicating.
Well, there's also like the first instance of like a more real connection with like the beings when she like takes off her hazmat suit. And she like, and everyone like, she's there with like two other dudes and Jeremy Renner, and they're like kind of freaking out. They're like, she's taking off her hazmat suit. What do we do? Oh my god! Oh my god! And she takes it off, and she's like, yeah, I'm fine. And then she like walks up, and with her name, like, well, what's her name again? Is it
Louise?
Louise. Oh yes, Louise. She's like Louise. Like points to herself up to this like big pane window glass, and it's a really cool scene.
So.
And we're just kind of going through the plot right now. We've gotten about halfway through it. Maybe halfway there?
I'd say this is like the big turning point in the film where things start to pick up. We see a lot of things moving quicker. Mm-hmm. Because after that first interaction, we do see them all kind of taken aback. Jeremy Renner's character throws up and is just kind of blown away by it. We get the introduction to the communication center in the military facility where they're communicating with all the other nations that... are trying to figure out what's going on. They're trying to collaborate, have it be like a united world so that things don't escalate, which like, inevitably they do.
Like they're sharing their information, as I think they are, with the other nations that also all supposedly are going up inside the pods and like trying to figure out, like trying to communicate with them, trying to talk with them. And then there's like the Chinese who are like taking a very like militaristic standpoint against these aliens. They've like blockaded them, and then... there's a couple other like news kind of things we hear about him. Like, there's like a conservative talk show that we hear about this guy that's just like, we need a shot across their bow, a show of force, like very like
Rush Limbaugh,
Alex Jones, Rush Limbaugh, crazy conservative maniacs. Uh-huh.
But it's interesting because it's those moments where we see the full scale of how long these soldiers have been there along with them. Because I almost wish we could have seen more of it sort of to break down, because you could see something was coming, but it still was interesting how this was like just sufficient enough for them to consider open revolt, to engage militarily with their own country, to potentially strike back at the aliens for fear that this is a big enough threat.
Yeah, they give you such like a rich enough storyline that it is tempting to say that you want to see like more of it and more like how other countries were dealing with this stuff. But I also have to say that I really, really appreciate the way that this movie kept track of its scope and kept the story centered from Amy Adams' perspective, because it like that's
if
exactly
it had, like,
what
cut to like other stuff, it would have just gotten too big.
That's exactly what kept it from being one of those obnoxious, run-of-the-mill, massive scale like blockbusters that come out. That's kind of what sci-fi has devolved into these days. Where like you could easily picture it having like, oh, Amy Adams' last like interaction with the aliens, and then bam, it cuts to like Russia, and then you get like
they're having their own interaction.
Courier font in the lower thing, like the ticker going by. It's like Russia, like the Moscow, 6:45 a.m. And then there's helicopters flying over. It just gets corny and stupid really quickly, and becomes just about massive scale and grandeur. And
we have the limited amount of communication with other countries and other people reacting to it as Amy Adams does.
Yeah, and we get a little bit of exposition for like what's going on in other places and news just via like the screens that they have in like the situation room and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
So I think this movie did an excellent job of keeping track of scope while also giving you glimpses of what's happening around like the rest of the world.
Yeah, there
like you saw little bits and pieces of like people looting and like markets around the world like crashing, and
which is like very limited.
Yeah,
like we're going way into depth
on that.
It's
like little snippets.
And what I liked is there was something described on a podcast I listened to about films making it feel as if it's been a long time without dragging on, without making it feel boring. Like, I was engaged the entire time because of how this became a puzzle, which I wasn't expecting. I was expecting it to be more of, this is like all about the awe of it, and it quickly gets over the awe of it and becomes more about the process of working through how to communicate. Because essentially they take the picture of the communication that the alien puts up in written form, begin to break down what it means, associate different words, potentially over like 6 months.
18 months, I think.
18 months?
I thought I heard them drop that somewhere in there. Wow.
Either way, it's been a long time that they're working through things.
There's kind of like a montage of like them like
walking back and forth,
bring in
demonstrating
like a big whiteboard in, and they draw like he walks, and it's like Jeremy Renner
walking,
yeah stuff like that. There's like the way the language of the aliens works is like really cool, because it's not like human language that's based on like a time. There's like a progression of time in human language where there's like you know what I mean, but like with his, or with like the alien language, like they don't have a concept of time, so everything they say is like all at once. Like they can express an entire complex thought
in like
all
one.
At the same time. Like there's no like they don't have to spend time going through an idea and like explaining it, like the entire thing. They can just express an entire idea or concept in one like fell swoop, which is like really cool.
Also very notable is that their words are structured like a plasmid DNA almost. It's like it's a circle that's just got these weird different variations, and there's like spikes coming off of the circle or some other little identifying differences between characters, but everything they say is like in one little circular thing.
And it can express whole like sentences of ideas.
Whole ideas or concepts, or like what would take like people an entire like page of writing or speech to like express, they can express in like a second.
I don't know why I like found that comparison really interesting, but I couldn't stop thinking about comparing it like plasmid DNA versus linear DNA. Eukaryotes, like humans, all have linear DNA that's in this long one strand, whereas bacteria have, they might have some linear DNA too, but they also have plasmids, which are just these circular DNA molecules. Kind of made me think of that.
Interesting.
What I also liked was how there was this sense of humor in like kind of an underlying theme, but what didn't feel out of tone, but sort of felt the characters acknowledging the ridiculous of the scenario when they named them Abbott and Costello. That was really funny, and it was those small moments of connection that end up like becoming much more important later to the two human characters we see, along with the scene where they're out in a truck looking up at it, which was one of my favorite scenes for a lot of different reasons. But it moves along very quickly. We see her setting up an office, putting up all these drawings or renderings of what it is, with like a literal pen circling the different indicators of words, being very methodical about this. It quickly shifts to become she's the most important person there.
Yeah.
She's the leader of what's going to be the biggest discovery of existence at this time. The whole world is going to change because of what she's doing. Mm-hmm. And eventually, they've communicated for long enough that
they can start like kind of figuring out what they're trying
right.
to say.
But it unfortunately makes it so that they send a message about a weapon, about how they're there to give them a weapon.
Yeah, like they translate something that they say that says use weapon.
Right.
Or at least that's what they think
the
it says.
The two words. Yeah. And that
and this,
sends
like, freaks
a panic.
The world out. Like China goes into like lockdown with like Russia.
Everyone
and,
else
like,
starts going
like,
into lockdown.
They start like cutting off communication with all these countries, which like brings in another big theme of like communication, because
ironically
it says like use weapon, and then like the people that went up into the pod before Amy Adams and Jeremy Renner went up there, they brought a bomb for some reason, because I don't know, they were rogue apparently, and they were like, yeah, we'll show them, we'll bring a bomb up there. So like they bring a bomb up there, set it down,
but like, this was after the use weapon comes out. And Amy Adams tries to approach it more methodically and say, there's still a lot we don't know. Yeah. Weapon could mean tool. Yeah. We don't know what this exactly means.
So she tries and goes up there and like reason with them.
With just him and Jeremy Renner. Yeah, yeah. They go without anybody because they've done it probably for, like you said, months and months and months. Yeah. So they're used to it at this point.
And like the beings, like they know that this bomb is there, which is really
I know.
Cool. Like you see them like tapping. Like these things are huge, by the way. They're like massive. Like the
entire
pods
buildings.
Are like hundreds of feet high,
yeah.
And they're like basically the entire inside of the pod. Like they're massive, and so they're like tapping on the screen, and they're like, "Well, like, what's going on?"
Because they've communicated and tried to ask what this means, and then they get an entire explosion of information to where they send out
like
hundreds of those
thousands
circles.
Of those tiny little circles. They're much smaller. There's some that are like fainter. There's like depth to it. But we find that out later, and what they do is like they like right before the bomb goes off, one of the alien thingies like mashes his hand tentacle thingy against like the screen, and it like sends them like flying backwards, and then they like shoot down like the shaft that they go up in, and then as they're falling down it, they like shift the gravity so they stop. So it was like really cool.
But it saves them.
Yeah, and like it shows that like these aliens like they know, like they're conscious of what's completely going on in front of them. Like they can understand us, really. Like I feel like a lot of what they were trying to do was for us to understand them. They were understanding us just fine. I think like they knew like whatever the thing they put down right there is a bomb. Like they knew that. Like they can see it and recognize it. So like these things are basically all knowing, I think. Like, I think they know exactly what's going on.
They also don't experience time. Like, if they experience everything at
non-linearly
one moment...
They experience time, just not in
like, they already
fashion.
Know what their entire world line is composed of. Mm-hmm. So, I feel like Abbott probably knew that he was going to die there.
True.
And Costello, the other one, probably also knew that Abbott would die there, mm-hmm. because they can experience all moments of their life simultaneously.
Yeah.
Which brings up a lot of moral implications for when Amy Adams begins to experience this later. Because we should put this out of the bag. This is the big spoiler.
Wait, actually, before we reveal that, I would like to say one thing that we didn't touch on earlier that becomes really important later is the theory of language changing the way you think. I can't remember what the word for it is, but Jeremy Renner brings this up to Amy Adams.
Well, in their first meeting.
Yeah, and he's like, hey, have you ever heard of this theory? And she's like, oh, yeah. And apparently it's that the whatever particular language you learn affects the way in which you think.
And then absolutely, yeah.
Eventually, the implication becomes
not
that,
just the way you think, the way you experience
right,
reality.
That the language that the aliens are sharing with, like, their own language that they're sharing with humans could also potentially change the way in which you think. And, I mean, in the movie, that means that could change the way that you object or subjectively experience reality, whatever objective reality is.
Which immediately makes me want to watch the movie again for a lot of reasons, because I really want to get to this, because I feel like this is worth talking about as it informs the last part of the movie.
Yeah.
The flashbacks from the beginning were not flashbacks. They were flash forwards. Amy Adams is seeing the child that she will have with Jeremy, like, with Jeremy Renner.
There's this like crazy scene where she's like inside the pod and she's like having like these flash somethings seem to start being like more and more like debilitating to her. Like she like keels over sometimes like from this. And you normally like earlier in the movie you're like, oh, she's so sad. It's like heartache that she's having.
And then she's trying to communicate with this alien.
And then she's just like, who is this girl? Like why are you showing me this? Who is this?
Because like, it should be noted.
And then you could like hear everybody in the theater just be like, oh my God.
What? Because then the whole like first like three quarters of the movie is just like
it changes everything.
It completely changes how you think about the movie, which is like why I like this movie so much. Like a good twist, like
makes you want to see it again to see how it informs
the
character.
It doesn't just change like
it's not
how the rest
thrill.
Of the movie is going to happen. It changes how the like how
the
you
entire
think about
movie.
The entire movie really,
yeah.
really
because
good.
It laid the groundwork Definitely. For this in a scene that was very reminiscent of Denis Villeneuve's other film Enemy, which I won't spoil. But the scene where she's having a dream. And then wakes up, and then Jeremy Renner's character is talking to her, but then one of the heptapods is in the room with her.
Oh, yeah.
Do you recall this?
Yeah,
I think it was directly after the explosion where she was knocked unconscious. And that immediately begins to say, this is more than just memories of a traumatic experience, which could have been it. That was really interesting. It could have been that her isolation came from this traumatic experience she had. But no, it's that this is something that's happening in the future. And she begins to see how she writes a book about the aliens' language. She talks to, we'll get to that later, but she talks to someone that becomes very important to like make sure that the world doesn't blow up the alien spaceships and cause this huge conflict. And
if they even could blow them up.
If they even could blow them up, but the idea is that risk, you don't know what then happens after that. Because one of the big themes of all science fiction movies, all the way back to the original, The Day the Earth Stood Still, is that we don't know the capabilities of another group of beings. We don't understand what they could do. But here they are in this instance where some people think that this is them trying to turn humanity against each other to then make it easier for them to take over. That they give them each a weapon so that they attack each other, and then that's it. But she thinks differently.
The flashbacks, air quotes, that Amy Adams was having were actually flash forwards of her daughter that she's going to have
with Jeremy Renner's character.
Yeah.
And the aliens inform her that the tool that they are trying to give them, the quote-unquote weapon that they want them to use, isn't some sort of like weapon of mass destruction or anything. It's their language. Because using their language is what allows her to think in a way that transcends linear time.
Mm-hmm. And like this big like explosion of language that the beings threw at them like before the bomb went off, Jeremy Renner like analyzes it and he shows that there's like depth to it, like it's a three-dimensional structure, and he says there's 1/12 of the total structure and there's 12 pods, but at this point all communication between all these nations has been shut off, so they're like, well, all these other nations probably have all the other chunks.
But
like,
they don't want to communicate.
But like, we can't communicate.
We're on radio
them.
Silence.
Like, so like, it brings in this like whole another big like theme of like communication, where it's like they need to communicate. Like that's
but
their saving grace. But they can't. So it brings this like barrier to communication that's like so prevalent in human life.
Which is then where we see the very interesting scene where she's flashing forward to being at this very prestigious dinner for probably world leaders and the most powerful people, and she meets with the Chinese head of state.
Is that the next part?
I think it was the general.
The general, or some high-ranking Chinese official who then talks with her and shares this piece of information that he had told his wife Do you remember this?
No, that happened. That happens after she goes up in the pod like Solo. Remember
I mean,
that?
Time's all nonlinear.
Oh well, if you're gonna get into that argument, there was the part before that where she like realizes like what's going on and she like
goes off on her own.
She goes off on her own, goes up under the pod, and at this point, all the pods have like risen like much higher up in the air, so they can't use the scissor lift to get up inside them.
Right.
So she just walks up to it, and this tiny little like individual pod like drops down, and she like gets inside it, goes up into the pod. And she's not in, like, the little corridor with the big window anymore. She's, like, inside the main area. Like, she's, like, face-to-face with these, like, towering
huge
beings. And apparently she can breathe in, like, the mist that they kind of inhabit in there. And they're, like, communicating, like...
And this
like
is where
throwing.
They subtitle it, which I assume means that she's somehow now able to understand
this
it.
This is also where we understand...
She has spent, like, 17 months learning the language. Yeah. So she's at the point where she can communicate with them.
She's also the best linguist in the world, apparently, so whatever. Anyway, this is where we learn why are they here. This was also my biggest problem with the movie.
Oh, let's hear it.
We learn that the reason why they're here is these beings, in 3,000 years, need our help.
4,000. Right.
4,000? Sorry.
A long 4, time
4,000 years, they need our help for something in their timeline.
Right.
They just need our help.
Right.
And then they just, like, don't talk about it. They're just like, oh, we need you. We need your help in 4,000 years. That's it. Okay, let's go on with the plot. And then they just never talk about it
again. Well, I'm assuming they know that what they do is enough.
Yeah, I know,
because
but, like, the whole... It's plastered on every movie. It's why are they here? Like,
right,
the whole
and
movie
we learn.
Is like, what's your... Yeah, that's like... I was expecting more of, like, a... Okay, well, like, what is it? Like, what are we gonna do about it? Like, they bring it up for like literally a minute, and then it's never mentioned again.
Sequel?
No, not a sequel.
I don't know.
This is a movie that doesn't have a sequel.
I really hope not.
Because
I was a little let down.
The reason I shy away from it being a sequel is because I think the not knowing is what's most interesting, because it opens up all these interesting thoughts about what could these beings who have achieved interstellar space travel, can view time non-linearly, what could they possibly need from us?
Yeah. And, like, whatever their ship is made out of is, like, not...
It's not...
Like, Jeremy Renner does this little, like, voiceover of, like, things that they're starting to, like, understand.
Yeah.
He talks about how, like, their ship doesn't emit any radiation. It doesn't emit sound. Like, it, like... They don't send messages back and forth. There's no, like, messages coming in or out of anything.
So
like,
it's beyond anything our understanding.
It's completely, like, whatever the ship is made out of is completely beyond our understanding.
I want to make a brief note about Jeremy Renner's character, Ian. A lot of people haven't liked him. They've thought he was underutilized in a lot of ways. I, again, am sort of the perspective that less is more, because it makes things really interesting, the moral decision she has to make to continue on to have a child that she knows she's going to lose, because it's that child that then is able to inform her about what is coming when it's making the clay, when she's talking with it. And you understand that, like,
It as in her daughter or the beings?
The beings.
Okay.
And you understand that Jeremy Renner's character, Ian, is going to be very upset about this because he leaves her. We get told that.
Yeah, like, when she comes out of this pod.
I know why my husband left
me. She's, like, freaking out, and Jeremy Renner's there, and he's just...
You had a husband?
Like, I know where my husband's gonna leave me, and he's like... Or,
yeah.
Which is kind of like...
I know why.
I'd be, like, so confused why she's telling me this right now.
But it's then that he becomes aware of the fact that she knew that they were going to have a child that would die, and she still made that decision anyway. Mm-hmm. Although we don't get to see it, it's really sad. This movie is so sad to me. The ending of them going, which we can get to after we kind of hustle through these last plot elements, the ending where we see the same shot from within the house, the great, great music reincorporation by Max Richter, who also does a lot of different music things for, like, The Leftovers and other such things.
Oh, that's where I recognize that.
Yeah.
Max Richter's score for The Leftovers is awesome.
I know. I've listened to it a bunch. But essentially, what happens before this is she is able to see through this non-linear, or through this linear barrier of time that we all have, to a conversation she has with the Chinese head of state, who we've seen brief snippets of, but seems very militaristic and seems like the one who's the big threat. And they kind of subvert that idea of, like, oh, this scary foreign threat is actually this human person who then understands, oh my gosh, you're sharing this conversation that you shouldn't be able to know. Here's what's at stake here.
Yeah, because, like, while they're, like, evacuating this base because the general is like, I've gotten orders from whoever to, like, evacuate. Like, everyone else is evacuating. Like, we're starting military options. There's, like, tanks, like... at the base and whatever, and she, like, steals, like, a satellite phone, and because of her, like, non-linear experience of, like, time now, kind of, she like knows the Chinese general's phone number, so she calls the Chinese general. And she's like locked herself in like the airlock chamber.
Jeremy Renner stands to protect her from the bullets.
And she tells the Chinese general his wife's dying, like last words, while there's also like they're cutting back and forth between this scene at this like gala where she's talking to the Chinese general, and the Chinese general is just like all of
you,
this.
Here's what you told
you.
Me.
Like, yeah. Here's what you told me. And he like repeats it to her.
It's so good.
Which is like interesting because it like. I was trying to think of like how like the timeline of the movie works.
I think that's sort of the point, is that it's outside our idea of how time functions linear for that to happen, because these things are happening at the same time. Yeah. If that makes sense. We could get into a whole conversation
about
this.
Yeah, I know. Like that last scene is like it's kind of mind-bending, because it's like how did the general know at like thinking back to like more linear time. At the time when she was in the airlock, Chinese general gets a call and is just like, this lady on the phone just told me my wife's dying words. Okay, I guess I'm gonna stop all military action like around the world. Like,
I have to assume she said something more than just those words to him.
Yeah.
I feel like the conversation had a little bit more depth to it than just like...
But it was the idea that she had the information that was so personal that it was able to open his eyes to... This expresses the importance of what's happening here and the implications of what we're dealing with, and it averts everything. And it's
like whoever's saying this is somebody who knows some sort of information that there's no way they could possibly know it unless they have some sort of like divine influence or something like that.
Right.
Like, it just shook him into the like recognizing the gravity of the situation and the fact that these are powers beyond his control and he needs to.
And what's interesting is this is a sacrifice she's making. For everything. She understands the implications of what she's doing. And the fact that she then, in order for this to continue the way it is, has to knowingly have a child that she's going to lose, which was the first interactions we see of it like falling apart at the beginning, which you always thought that this is like informing her character, which is why she's so isolated. But it ends up being that yes and no. It both informs her character and is also like the driving force that makes it so that she makes this decision. Now we get into the really circular time thing of it all. But I really liked the ending because of how it became about her as a character and the human decision she has to make, where she's willing to like make the sacrifice and still do these things. I don't know. It's worth seeing a second time just with that knowledge. Yeah. But it's... I really liked it.
Jeremy Renner also delivers like the cheesiest line ever.
Which one?
He's like they're
wanna
both
wanna make a baby.
Not
that one.
Okay.
Yes, that one. But the other one, like they're sitting in like the back of a pickup truck,
after
the beings like have left, and he's sitting there and he's like,
no, that was
before. That was that when they were there?
That was one of the scenes I really liked. That was kind of in the middle that I felt was absolutely necessary.
There were two scenes when they were sitting in the back of a pickup truck.
At some point, probably.
There was one where he was like, you know, you approach language like a mathematician.
Yeah.
And then there was one later where he was like, I spent all this time staring up at the stars when I could have been staring at you.
Yeah.
I was just I could see it coming
a little bit, but I felt like it was in line with his character in that he says these types of things.
I don't know if you can just write off a bad line.
I'm not writing it off as a bad line.
I don't know. I didn't like that line. There was also a line later.
I think that one was fine. I think people are blowing that out of proportion. The other one was really bad, though. The want to make a baby.
But, I mean, it's his character. Like, he from the beginning is just sort of this, like, very macho, suave guy that can pull off such a BS thing to, like,
yeah,
that
he's
to
a
say.
Corny dude.
Yeah, exactly. I'm not writing it off.
In the context of his character. It's not like we were supposed to watch that and associate, like... Watch him say stuff like that and just think like, oh wow, he's amazing, this is such amazing
but
writing.
The thing that makes it makes it that much more sad for me because of the cavalier nature and how like it's like so happy sounding, however ridiculous it is to say it like that. You probably shouldn't talk about having a child with someone in that way, but knowing what happens to that child makes that line just like he's very clearly happy about this. Mm-hmm. And it's like, because at this point they thought the world could possibly be ending. And while there's a whole lot to talk about why we consider children to represent the future in all these ways, whether it's like, oh, save the world for our children, this is him acknowledging that there's a future to be part of. And that's what made it interesting to me. Any other closing thoughts on this most recent film?
Amazing cinematography, great directing, average writing at times. Didn't really like Forest Whitaker's character. Other than that, amazing movie.
I would have liked to have seen more from Forest Whitaker's character. I feel
of his actual character, but yeah. He was just like really expositional at times.
Right, right.
It alleviated a lot of my fears about the upcoming Blade Runner sequel.
Mm.
Denis Villeneuve is signed on. I don't care. Denis Villeneuve is signed on to direct the new Blade Runner sequel, starring Ryan Gosling and Harrison Ford is reprising.
Ooh, he is.
Yeah. What's her name? Robin Wright is in it as well.
Oh.
I think Jared Leto is also in it.
Oh.
And amazing cast, amazing source material to work from. I was worried just because I hate sequels in general. I think they usually ruin the original
movie. But here's someone that is very good at their craft, especially science fiction.
And it's shown me that he's ready to tackle a really philosophical, really good sci-fi story.
Because there could
be whole
books
written. Which is what the original Blade Runner was.
Yeah, there could be whole books written about the philosophy in this movie, I feel like.
Or Blade Runner. I mean, there have been scholarly articles written about the philosophy of Blade Runner and Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, which is Philip K. Dick's source material that the movie came from. But yeah, so I'm feeling a lot better about it. I'm still a little tentative, but definitely going to see it. And
I want to say one closing note. If you haven't, you should listen to Max Richter on The Nature of Sunlight. It's really good. It's that song towards the end. But I've been Chase.
Jeremy.
I'm Skyler. Thanks for listening, everyone.
Have a good rest of your day, everybody.